Think about your day so far. Think about everything you did so far in your day. Now think about which of those things would be impossible in the late 18th century. All the technology you used, you know, and you drove somewhere, for example. You took an elevator. You took an antibiotic. Think about all that stuff, because the people who wrote the Constitution didn't have any of that stuff. They lived very, very differently. They had no Office Max, unless you count Jonathan Trumbull. They had no way of getting a whole bunch of things that are just kind of basic to your life. So we're going to talk about that today. A.J. Jacobs spent a year living constitutionally. He's going to explain what that was like and what he learned about this great republic of ours while doing it.
In 1787, untold, our founding fathers did agree to write a list of principles for keeping people free. The USA was just starting out, a whole brand new country, and so our people spelled it out, the things that we should be.
Wow. Nicki Minaj has really changed her sound. No, actually, that's from Schoolhouse Rock. It's, I think, a very influential song for our guest today. Our guest is A.J. Jacobs, the author of The Year of Living Constitutionally, One Man's Humble Quest to Follow the Constitution's Original Meaning. His previous books include Drop Dead Healthy and The Year of Living Biblically. He's also the host of the Puzzler podcast. I would say, heuristically, that this is A.J.'s third visit to our show, but I could be off by a factor of two, let's say. But first of all, A.J. Jacobs, welcome back to our show, however many times you've been on it.
Thank you, Colin. Yes, three is my estimate as well.
All right. So I should tell you, you know, we're working on a show right now about polymaths, and maybe we should have you back as Mr. Know-It-All.
But I'm ready for number four. You tell me.
So A.J., first of all, explain this bold experiment. You've lived a life of bold experiments. This is the newest one. Explain what it was.
Absolutely. Well, I realized a couple of years ago I had never read the Constitution. I did know the preamble thanks to Schoolhouse Rock, which you just played, but I never read the whole thing. But then every day I would read in the news that this 230-year-old document was having a huge impact on how I live my life, and on and it's still sparking massive debates. So I thought, I'm going to try to understand what the Constitution really says, what it really means. And as you mentioned, Colin, the way I like to do that is to immerse myself, to dive in and live it. It's how I explored the Bible for a book I wrote called The Year of Living Biblically. So for that one, I followed the Ten Commandments. I grew a huge beard and wore sandals.
Or my favorite thing, I believe you brought a portable stool onto the New York subway because the Bible forbid you from sitting where a menstruating woman would have sat before. You just figured everything
yes.
was out.
Thank you for remembering. Absolutely. I have my little safety stool. So I actually, it was a bizarre experience, as you can imagine, but it was also very enlightening. And I decided that I wanted to take the same approach to the Constitution and follow its original meaning from the 1790s to try to understand it. So I carried a musket on the Upper West Side of New York, where I live. I renounced social media in favor of the quill pen you just mentioned. I tried to get into the mindset of the founders. I'm wearing my tricorn hat. You can't see it right now, but I am wearing it. And again, it was absurd at times. But I do feel I gained some real insights into this fascinating document and into the future of democracy. And I feel a little empowered. I feel a little more optimistic, which I needed. I needed desperately in this time.
The get up, if I may call it that, it makes you just a perfect guest for television, and people can see AJ talking to a clearly delighted John Dickerson on CBS Sunday Morning in full constitutional regalia with musket. And I also, AJ, I have to tell you, we'll get into this a little bit in a second, but in 2023, you paid a visit to Senator Ron Wyden's office, and I found the tweet by somebody named Allison Pecorin, who I believe is a member of the Capitol Press. And there's a picture of you, once again, dressed in your getup, and it says, "Good morning from the U.S. Senate, Senator Ron Wyden, and this man, .. an author dressed in colonial garb who is spending a year living constitutionally," in quotes. Also, the look on Ron Wyden's face is priceless. He's definitely playing it for all it's worth. Like, who is this lunatic?
Yes, I am proud to be this man, as I was referred to by that reporter. But yeah, that was part of it. I went and visited the government because it's my constitutional right to petition Congress for a redress of grievances. And I was in the full tricorn hat and breeches, and he took me to a little mini press conference with a dozen reporters, and I had to explain what I was doing. And I had to say that I believe, which is true, that Congress should have more power and the president should have less, because that is what the founders envisioned. And he liked that because he's in Congress.
Well, I mean, we should say, as long as we're on this, let's just play this whole one out. It's a pretty good example of the kind of things that go on in the book. So you were there to petition Ron Wyden. You had brought, in the form of kind of a scroll on, late 18th century appropriate paper product,
right,
written in quill, a petition. And the idea was that you were reverting back to an idea that was toyed with during the Constitutional Convention. Several constitutional delegates, I wouldn't know, it might have been, was it Wilson who proposed? Somebody proposed that there should be three presidents.
That's right. James Wilson was the one who said, why don't we have one president?
That's right.
And when he brought that up at the Constitutional Convention, and several delegates said, are you insane? I don't think they said that. They said
Virginia delegate Edmund Randolph called the idea the fetus of monarchy.
Exactly. He was afraid. He said, we just fought a bloody war to get rid of a king, and now you're just going to appoint one person to be head of government? That is a terrible idea, the fetus of monarchy. And he wanted a council of presidents, three presidents, seven presidents, 12 presidents. And eventually, it was debated for weeks, but eventually the one president idea won out. But I think the fear of the fetus of monarchy has come true. The president, and I'm talking about Republican and Democrat, has way much more power than the founders envisioned. And I can cite examples. But the point was, I was saying, let's try to rein in the president. What about three presidents, like co-presidents? So they're all working together in the Oval Office. And I did my petition. I got hundreds of people to sign it. And I brought it to Ron Wyden, senator, and I unspooled it on his floor. So it covered his whole floor. And he said that he thought it was an interesting idea. So, which means he thought about it for 5 seconds and then said, no, that's not a good idea. But he did agree with the thesis that the president is too powerful. And I actually don't want three presidents. Like, the idea of Biden, Trump, and RFK Jr. co-working and the Oval Office, that's not a great idea. But there are ways to put guardrails on our democracy by raiding in the president. And that is really what I was after.
Also, under the current plan, apparently you wouldn't be able to abort a president after 6 weeks or something if he's the fetus of monarchy. Well, you buried my favorite part of the story. So, and I think it has to be established that the kind of co-star of this book is your, 80% patient wife. Although the best parts of the book are when your wife, those 20% where she just loses it and says no. But one of the things she's worried about, because you're conducting all of your affairs with a quill pen, and which therefore involves a bottle of ink, and you dipping your quill pen into the bottle of ink, is that it's going to get all over the house, which it doesn't do. It gets all over. Well, you finish the story when you visit Ron Wyden.
Oh, my goodness. Yes. Well, I was taking notes, as I am a writer. So So I had my quill and my inkwell, and somehow I spilled the ink on his red carpet in his senatorial office. And so there's a big splotch, big, I don't know, Jackson Pollock-like splotch on Ron Wyden's carpet forever. And I felt so guilty about this that I did something I've never done, which is I asked my accountant to add $50 to my taxes so that maybe it'll go towards cleaning the carpet, because I just don't.
Well, yeah, partly that was because Julie, who really is the co-star of this book, your wife said, maybe some kid is not going to get a textbook because they have to spend money cleaning Ron Wyden's carpet, which activated all the A.J. Jacobs guilt sensors. They were like just beeping wildly and flashing lights.
Exactly. So hopefully it's been cleaned up. Who knows?
So, you know, I think about my day so far. We're recording this at 10 o'clock in the morning. So, I mean, I got up. I had to go walk my dog. So I popped in some wireless earbuds so I could listen to Jeffrey Rosen's podcast, We the People, which is an influential thing for your book. But I'm in Costco kind of a hurry, AJ, because we have this 10 a.m. taping. So I had Jeffrey Rosen and his guest talk at 1.25 speed. I went to work on on the outline for this show, which I have here on my iPad. I got into my Subaru. I drove to work. I got in the elevator to come up. You can see where I'm going here. An old friend of mine, Hugh McGill, who's no longer with us, was the dean of the UConn Law School. He said one time that the people who wrote the Constitution had living conditions closer to those of the Roman Empire than to modernity, that so many things that just impregnate our lives weren't there at the time. And that, in a way, is a lot of what your book is about. What's it like to live the way the people lived when they were thinking out what is still the structure of our government?
Right. It is amazing that they wrote this document in the conditions that they were in. And I am still astounded. And I did try to replicate that a bit, since that was the idea was to get inside the heads of the founding fathers. So I wrote by candlelight, and I, which by the way, I used at the beginning, I used beef tallow candles, which smell like meatloaf. So I don't recommend those. But I will never take for granted a lot of the modern conveniences. We have a ton of problems now, and we need to solve them, but we should not have some sort of false nostalgia for better days. And so I'll just give you one small example. I mean, the big examples are sexist, racist, dangerous, smell. It was just, you died when you were 40. Mm. But a small example is I was putting on my uniform, my get up, as you call it, and my socks. I had to put on these stockings that had no elastic, so they fall down to the ankles. Every morning I had to put on sock belts. They're not even garters. Garters are too sophisticated. These are just belts that you put on top of your socks to keep them from falling down. So I'll never get those combined hours back. And I will never take elastic for granted again. I will never take elastic or democracy for granted again. Those were the two takeaways from the book.
Yeah. By the way, the candle smelling like meatloaf, I think that's another Julie joke. I feel like I should represent her here. I think she needs to get more of the proceeds.
Thank you. I'm going to tell her. Yeah, she will be appreciative.
But yeah, the point that you're making, I think, is expressed by one of the reenactors that you spoke with, the sort of, Revolutionary War type reenactors, who said life took longer back then.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the fact that they all gathered in Philadelphia. And that, I will say, it had its pros and cons, because I do think the Constitution would never have been written if people had iPhones. It would have been leaked to the press or to a website, and people would have been outraged. And they knew they needed total secrecy, which is weird, because in a sense, it's sort of elitist and non-transparent way to try to create a democracy. But they shut the windows in that hot Philadelphia summer, and because they didn't want eavesdroppers, and they wrote it without any interference from anyone else.
All right, let's just talk about that for a second. This is another Hugh McGill-ism. He was the dean of the UConn Law School and a great legal scholar. Another point that he used to make is, we wouldn't tolerate any of this today. In other words, we would not tolerate a fundamental document of government, never mind the foundational document of government, being written A, in secrecy, B, by 55 white males, 54 Protestants and one token Catholic. You know, that kind of, who by the way, and I want to get into this with you, were day drinking.
A lot, yeah.
While they were writing the Constitution. Most of this is not kind of a recipe for democracy as we understand it in 2024. Most of this feels kind of fundamentally wrong. The actual process by which we arrive at the Constitution seems just, you know, from the get-go, kind of tainted by all kinds of bad stuff.
Oh, yeah. Well, it is fascinating. And it is quite a paradox that what is supposed to be the beacon of equality and democracy was formed by, as you say, 55 white men and some of them slaveholder owners. And the question is, which I address in my book, what do we do with that fact? Some argue we should burn the Constitution. And that was actually the solution of William Lloyd Garrison, who was a great abolitionist before the Civil War. He literally burned the Constitution because he said it was a pact with the devil. I found Frederick Douglass's approach fascinating and inspiring because he said the opposite. He said, this is a flawed document made by flawed men, but it contains the seeds of a great society. It contains, he called it a promissory note and for equality and liberty. And that America needs to live up to that promissory note. So it's our job as citizens to try to make that happen. So I agree. It is a fascinating that the beginning was messy, and it was not a was certainly not a virgin birth. It was a messy process. But can we still work with that document and try to make America the best it can be? And I hope so.
I mean, that's one of the serious questions that underscores what is also a very, very funny book. And we'll come to that, too. I mean, I do think there are some real questions about that, and they dog us today. We should probably say also that one of the reasons you're doing this is that we are, contrary to Madonna's claim, we are living in an originalist world. We are living in, I mean, your friend Jeffrey Rosen, I think, would say that this book would have pack a little less punch during the time of the Warren Court or the Burger Court, where an awful lot of questions were pursued kind of as basic policy questions, as opposed to what did a bunch of people in 1789 think about this. But we're living in a time where the court is heavily populated by, if not dominated by, people who feel like text in history is where you start.
Right. And just since I didn't know much about this before I started, just a brief intro to that. There are, of the Supreme Court, about five of the conservative justices consider themselves some sort of originalist, meaning, like you said, that the most important thing in interpreting the Constitution is the original meaning of the words when it was ratified. So it's like a recipe. You don't change it. You try to figure out what was the original meaning. On the other side are living constitutionalists or pluralists or pragmatists, they're sometimes called. And they say, yes, look at the original meaning, but also look at the consequences that a Supreme Court ruling might have. Look at the purpose of the law. Look at all sorts of factors and weigh them in and then make the decision. And that is, they result in fundamentally different views of the world. And the Dobbs decision was an originalist decision. The Bruin decision about gun control, that was also an originalist decision. And so it is a crucial debate. And that's one of the reasons for the book.
So, yeah, I think we should also acknowledge that this is a costume of convenience at times. And so, for example, in the very recent oral arguments involving the question of whether the president, president is immune from criminal prosecution even after his or her presidency, you know, the originalists are kind of on the other side. In fact, a group of historians, and I talked to the lead historian recently, filed an amicus brief saying, this is so not what the founders had in mind and the framers have in mind. Here's how I can show you this. And, mm-hmm. and particularly if you look at the stuff that was being written to sell the Constitution, all of the essays and stuff like that that were being written in newspapers and stuff, it is clear that they wanted to avoid anything like a king. One of the ways that they wouldn't like to have a king would be to have somebody who could just do anything and it would be the law and you couldn't be prosecuted. And the so-called originalists on the court were going, yeah, well, what if somebody, has a space laser and they pointed? I mean, they were like bringing up stuff that was clearly. So, I mean, yeah, everybody's an originalist until they don't feel like it, right?
Right. Well, that is a huge criticism and I think a valid one of much of originalism. And you're right. First of all, I agree with your friend. They would have been appalled. As we talked about, they were terrified of monarchy. There are two questions when it comes to originalism. First, are the originalists on the Supreme Court actually figuring out what the original meaning was? And second, is that the best way to make decisions? And I would argue probably not in both of those questions. And I go through in various ways that the idea of guns and the idea of free speech and so much more at the founding was so fundamentally different from the way both sides see it, both liberals and conservatives, that we don't want to go back to that because it is a very strange world.
All right, we're going to take a little pause here. AJ is going to be with us for the whole show today. The book is The Year of Living Constitutionally, One Man's Humble Quest to Follow the Constitution's Original Meaning. AJ Jacobs will be back. Just thought I'd have James Brown remind us that the Constitution was written in a man's world, where, in fact, women were essentially not considered in terms of the vote or much of anything else. With us is A.J. Jacobs, the author of The Year of Living Constitutionally, One Man's Humble Quest to Follow the Constitution's Original Meaning. And he joins us now. Maybe we should begin. Well, actually, let's talk a little bit about freedom of speech and freedom of the press. These are freedoms in the Bill of Rights and the First Amendment that are dear to your heart. I think it's important to note that in the late part of the 18th century, in the early 19th century, freedom of speech wasn't quite, or freedom of the press for that matter, wasn't quite the way that we understand it today, right? You write that it mostly revolved around the concept of prior restraint.
Right. I'm a huge fan of free speech, as I imagine most journalists are, but I'm a fan of the 20th century version of free speech. With the free speech really expanded in the 1940s, interestingly, with a series of lawsuits by Jehovah's Witnesses, but that's another topic. The original free speech in the 1790s was much more constrained. They did not see free speech as an absolute right. They said, you can print whatever you want, but the government can come in and there will be consequences. So they were much more concerned about sedition, especially the Federalists. So there were sides that were a little more into free speech, not as much as now. But they it was a fragile democracy. It was in its infancy, and they did not want people criticizing it. So John Adams had these sedition laws. Thomas Jefferson let them lapse, but they were considered constitutional by the Federalists. States had so much latitude to restrict speech. I wouldn't say it was Stalinist Russia, but it was not what we think of as America. There were laws against blasphemy, laws against cursing. You said in New York at the time of the Constitution, if you said a curse or the word damn, you would have to pay 37.5 cents. That was the fine per curse.
We should say that you tried to institute this rule in your household, although there were a lot of rounding error issues about that 37.
Exactly. I have teenage sons. I thought, this is great. I can try to clean things up. And yeah, like you said, they objected. They said, I don't have a half cent. So they got out of it.
Well, they actually saw that as a permission structure to swear a second time so that 75 cents is a more workable amount of money. So they really kind of interpreted it like, I should probably swear one more time so I can actually pay my fine in a sensible manner.
Right. Yes, they were very good at loopholes, which is something you know that legal scholars also talk about.
They should have had a few teenagers at the Constitutional Convention because they would have said, they should have had Jeff Spicoli there. He could have gone, hey, man, what if people just swear more? I just want to go back to something that you said because it's really important. And because I'm sitting here in Connecticut, I don't want to let Thomas Jefferson too far off the hook. But you're absolutely right that states, you know, circa in the early 19th century, states just applied these incredibly restrictive laws on speech. Here in Connecticut, because it was a Federalist state, you know, they would fine people for, or I mean, Republican printers and newspaper editors would be charged with seditious libel. And sometimes if they refused to pay their fine, they'd go to jail. And Jefferson gets so tired of Connecticut and so tired of the Federalists, and he doesn't really get his fingerprints on this, but it's pretty clear that he's behind it. He actually starts arresting people under that law. He starts having people arrested, including what was then the Connecticut Current. The editors and publishers of the Connecticut Current were charged with seditious libel for publishing, and it was fake news, to be fair. It was an article in the Current that said that that Jefferson was giving a certain amount of money to France, a large amount of money to France, in order to buy Florida, which doesn't really make any sense because Spain had Florida. You'd have to give it to Spain. But so that's how you know it was fake news. But he was so ticked off about this that they were charged with seditious libel. And that one went all the way to the Supreme Court. Jefferson eventually wanted to drop these charges. Part of it was because there was some minister in Litchfield, Connecticut, who'd been talking about him as an adulterer, and witnesses were going to be called to talk about his affair with the wife of a General Walker. He just thought that trial maybe shouldn't go forward. But, you know, to the point being, neither Adams nor Jefferson. Jefferson said he'd rather have a government where you lost democracy but kept newspapers than the other way around. He wouldn't want to have democracy and not have newspapers. That's how reverent he was about them until he was suing them. Anyway, I'm babbling because this whole thing bothers me. But you should say a little bit more about that. There was not a big commitment to the First Amendment free speech as we know it.
Well, that is fact. I did not know that part. I mean, I knew that Jefferson, who was the most committed to some sort of free speech, was not fully committed. But that hypocrisy is very interesting. I do remember in my book, I looked at Connecticut's laws. I'm pretty sure it was Connecticut. And they had some laws against all sorts of free expression, like acrobatics. They had laws against that.
We still frown on that. Oh, the juggling is, you know, we still frown on that kind of thing. I don't think it's statutory anymore.
There you go. But yeah, as you say, the point is it was a much more restrictive environment, and neither side would want to go back to the First Amendment. So the progressive side, of course, would not like the restrictions against sedition, and the conservative side with Citizens United, which said that donating money to political campaigns by corporations is considered free speech. And I think the founding fathers, at least according to the scholars I talked to, would be appalled. They would say, no, that is not free speech. That is, and they were very concerned about corruption, money and corrupting politics. So neither side wants to go back. So that is one of the points of the book is let's look at the original meaning of the words, but just one factor. We don't want to go back to a society where you can't say the S word or F word. Most of us don't. I don't.
Well, it would be highly inconvenient anyway. We should also say, as long as we're on the subject of Connecticut, and you reference this in the book, Connecticut had an official state religion until, I think, 1818. Congregationalism was the state religion of Connecticut. You know, screw you, Baptists and Quakers and people like that. Right. Probably would get fined 37.5 cents for having said screw you. But, you know, I mean, once again, the Constitution says one thing, but the states for a long time could do what they want.
Right. It wasn't until after the Civil War and the 14th Amendment that the Bill of Rights was considered to apply to the states. So overall, the states have lost power. They're trying to gain some back with the Dobbs ruling on abortion, for instance. But in the beginning, you know, the state, and this does make sense, because at the convention before, it was almost like the European Union. They were almost like their own little countries, and they had to figure out, how do we unify this country?
So I want to talk about two things involving food. The first is,
I love it.
Well, we're coming to cake. There's no way to have this.
Okay, good.
But before we get to cake, it wouldn't be an H.A. Jacobs book if you didn't subject other people to your own regime. So you decided you would have a constitutionally accurate dinner party. Actually,
right.
Before we get to the dinner party, like, my favorite part of this whole story is not the dinner party. It's this is so A.J. Jacobs, going to a farmer's market with gold and silver. Explain all of that.
Yes, the founding fathers were very skeptical of paper money. And I don't think they would not have liked any money nowadays, because money needed to be backed by gold and silver. That was the real money. Everything else was sort of fake. And so, to be fully originalist, I figured I've got to revert back to gold and silver. So I bought a bunch of gold on the internet, and in sort of gold flakes. And I brought my scale, and I went to the farmer's market to buy my carrots and celery. And I asked, can I pay in gold? And I got some people, they thought about it. They thought it. They were said, well, maybe soon. Which I think they meant, like, the apocalypse is coming soon and we won't have money. So maybe then, but for now, I was able to pay for my regimental coat, which is part of my getup, with gold, because it was from a reenactor.
No, I like that maybe soon part. It was like, just wait, just got to get a little bit more Mad Max, and then, yeah, we'll take your gold. So then you have this dinner party at which you're serving food on pewter and stuff like that. Explain a little bit about how that went.
Yeah, the food was, we served, my son Zane is the chef of the family, so he made beef stew with cloves. They loved cloves. Everything had cloves. And I invited about a dozen people from all over the political spectrum, because this is, as you mentioned earlier, the right to assemble is very important. And I do think that is another part of 18th century life that is worth revisiting, which is meeting in person with people you disagree with and talking things through. And so overall, despite the cloves and the beef stew, it was a great experience. Another downside was I told some jokes from an 18th century joke book that were not well received.
I liked that joke. I thought it was pretty funny. I mean, I wasn't laugh out loud funny, but it was the multiply joke is pretty funny.
Right. Yeah. Just quickly. So it was the joke was, there was a mathematician who had no children. Someone told his wife, oh, your husband is so good at math. And she said, yes, but not at multiplying. So there you
boom.
Go. Ba-dum-bum.
Boom.
Boom.
I just want to say, and I don't know how aware you are of this, but there is a really good historical reference point in that dinner party. Beginning in 1793, I'm reading from Michael Schutzen's book, The Good Citizen, A History of American Civic Life. Beginning in 1793, popular associations sprang up in the New Republic to debate public questions, criticize government, and influence public policy. There were about 40 of them. I'm skipping over a lot. And I think they, you know, they met at night. I don't know whether they had dinner, but there were these clubs where you talked about stuff. And there was one, for example, and they did what you did, too, which was try to get people of slightly differing political orientations. Not all the clubs did this. Some of them were like just Federalist clubs. But the Political Society at Mount Prospect, New Jersey, wrote in its constitution, are several of you disposed to advocate an aristocratical or a monarchical government? Where there is real opposition of sentiment and a well-regulated discussion, the righteous cause will probably shine with an additional luster. So, AJ, their point was, yeah, let's get some people together and talk about this. And, you know, and let's make sure that we don't all agree, because that'll make it even better.
Fascinating. I love this, because I love learning history from you. Like, I felt I knew a lot. I did a lot, a crash course for this book, but I love that you are teaching me stuff that I didn't know. So for the sequel, I am coming to you.
I don't want that kind of responsibility. All right. So we have to talk about cake. Cake, if there's a unifying force in this book, a force that connects the beginning of the book to the end of the book, it might be cake. So explain why that would be. Talk about election
cake. Yes, well, election day in the 1790s, it had a lot of downsides. Of course, it was sexist and racist. But there was one aspect for those who were privileged enough to vote that I thought was interesting, which was it was much more festive. I wouldn't say it was Coachella, but it was. There was music. There was rum punch. People were so excited to have this new right. And there was election cake, which was made with cloves, of course. And it was started in the state of Connecticut. So thank you, Connecticut, for that tradition. And I just thought this is such a lovely idea. Let's try to revive it. So I started this movement on Facebook, which I know is not 18th century-ish. That's more, I don't know what that would be. Prodigy would be more appropriate. But I decided to get people from all 50 states to bake election cakes. They didn't have to have cloves. And it was probably my favorite part of the whole experience, because there's so much negativity and there's so much cynicism that people, I was moved, and people wrote me how moved they were to have this one little bit of positivity, just baking a cake, bringing it to the polls. Our catchphrase was, democracy is sweet, maybe too cute, but that was what we said. And people were so excited to have this one little thing. And there is studies by Yale scientists, actually, another Connecticut link, that say if you make an election more festive, make the polls more festive, people will turn out more. It'll get out the vote. So it is a small thing in one way, but it's also part of a bigger idea to remind ourselves the joy of democracy. We have a long way to go. There are real things we can do, like getting rid of gerrymandering, but let's at least let's have cake and try to get people reminded of this amazing right we have.
Yeah, and so, I mean, does this cake have legs? What's going to happen in 2024? Is there more election cake on the
way? I hope the cake have legs. I am doing it again, and I've got a lot of people signed up. And please, if you're out there and listening, and my friend, by the way, Jen Fallon was one of our Connecticut bakers, and she brought it to the Darien Public Library. I would love for people. So find me on my website or Twitter or whatever it is. And please join the movement, because it's so fun. People post pictures and it just is something I felt I needed mentally, psychologically, for this incredibly stressful time in democracy.
We should say that once again, in revolutionary times and early time period of our democracy, it's like the Monty Python skit about spam, except it was cloves. It's like cloves have to be in everything. So so cloves, I mean, theoretically, cloves have to be in the cake. I mean, if you're going to be super accurate about it.
Right. There are recipes that I can send people. It's got figs. It's got cloves. But I'm not a cake dictator. I'm democratic. So people went with all sorts of recipes, and they made it their own. So the Connecticut cake had nutmegs on it, of course. Mm-hmm. And the Georgia cake had peaches. So people really took it and made it individual.
I don't think you've used the phrase "great awakening" yet,
yeah, that was my name for the project, which no one else seemed to like.
No, I really like it. Now, part of that is because
you,
I'm the type of person who knows a lot about the Great Awakening and the second Great Awakening. I feel this is the one moment in your book, AJ, where you are right and Julia's wrong. As your marriage counselor, She's right pretty much the rest of the time.
Well, this year can be the second grade awakening. Yeah. So that's great.
So I just want to say, if you're interested in doing this here in Connecticut, I'm spontaneously deciding that this is something we want to do. You can email us at colinshow, all one word, colinshow@ctpublic.org. Let us know if you're interested in making a cake for Election Day. We'll provide lawyers so you don't get arrested for having your cake outside the 75-foot limit or whatever it is. But I think it's a great idea. So, yeah, write to us if you want to do
the cakes. That is so exciting.
Yeah.
Wow, look at that. I got chills. This is great. Thank you, Colin.
I don't really have the power to deliver on any of my promises, but let's just say that we'll provide lawyers.
I like it. It was an arbitrary exercise of power, which is very unconstitutional. Right.
Although
we
have a plan to have three hosts of this show because it just seems fairer somehow. All right, we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back, finish up with AJ, and so stay with us. We're back. It's my privilege to say that the technical producer of today's show is the maestro, Dylan Reyes. The senior producer of the Colin McEnroe Show is Lily Tyson. She produced this episode. Our guest is A.J. Jacobs, the author of The Year of Living Constitutionally, One Man's Humble Quest to Follow the Constitution's Original Meaning. So I want to talk a little bit about the takeaways here. And let me just say that I am kind of Jeffersonian about the Constitution in the sense that you mentioned that his idea was every 19 years, let's just do a new Constitution. Mm. Now, that seems like a tight window to me, but I have said to one of your correspondents in this book, Akhil Reed Amar, we need a new Constitution. We can't amend this Constitution. It's really, really hard to do it, although you do explain how one person did. And so here's this, you know, antiquated, arthritic document that we can't change. Other countries get new constitutions, you know, much more regularly than we do. So, but how do you feel about the Constitution right now?
Well, I think it's got, I like to say, you know, it's got its wonderful, inspiring, amazing parts, like the preamble, and then it's got its problematic parts. And one of them is how hard it is to amend. And I don't think the founders anticipated. They didn't see this rigid two-party system coming. So they thought it would be much easier to amend. You don't want it totally easy to amend, but you want to be able to make some changes because they knew it was imperfect. George Washington wrote to his nephew and said, this is an imperfect document, and it's up to the future to change it. I will say, I see the allure of a new constitution. I also fear a new constitution, that it could go exactly the way I don't want it to go, with, for instance, states taking all the power away from the federal government. And I think we need a balance. So I'm scared of a new constitution. But that is the other alternative, is this approach of interpreting the Constitution in a much more elastic way. So using, as I said, many different approaches. Yes, the original meaning, but also what are the consequences? What are the what was the purpose of these rules at the beginning? So I like looking at the Constitution from the highest level. and the part about equal protection. Yes. Parts about we the people, about the general welfare. I think we forget about the general welfare a lot and focus too much on individual rights. They were very concerned about balancing individual rights and our civic duty and responsibility. So looking at the high level of the Constitution, which has some wonderful thoughts about equality and liberty, and maybe not focusing on what were the 18th century laws about guns or medicine and being obsessed with that.
So at the end of the book, you have these this great section of takeaways. And we there are things like think slow, embrace virtue, talk less, smile more. You know, that's from Hamilton. By the way, have you noticed Hamilton kind of yada yadas the writing of the Constitution? It's like
interesting.
There's the Revolutionary War, and then there's a big fight between him and Jefferson. But it's kind of like when did the Constitution get written?
That's hilarious.
But
the director's cut might happen.
Yeah, there you go. So, but I don't know. We don't have enough time to run through them all. But pick one or two of your takeaways and talk a little bit about them. Pick your own favorites.
All right. Well, one of my favorites is the idea that changing your mind is a patriotic thing to do. Ben Franklin at the Constitution said, "The older I get, the less certain I am of my opinions." He also told this little joke parable about, he said, there was a French lady who said to her sister, "Why is it that I'm the only person I've ever met who is correct on every single issue?" And his point was, we're all the French lady. We all think we're right all the time. And that has gotten worse in America. We've become so entrenched and so inflexible that we won't look at the evidence that contradicts our point and evolve to a different point of view. So I would say the founders had their flaws, but flexible thinking was something we need to recapture and make it patriotic. Make it so that it's not a bad thing. Oh, you're a flip-flopper. No, it's a good thing. Oh, you looked at the evidence and said, oh, this is a better way to go.
Could I inject one thing there? Because I think it's germane, and which is that at the Constitutional Convention, there was a question of, will we keep a written record of how we vote on each question?
Right.
And that was discarded. And George Mason said at the time that people might be reluctant to change their minds if it was clear how they'd voted on the question before, and that it would be better if people could just look at it and go, oh, yeah, I thought that was a good idea last round. It's clear to me how bogus it is, as Spicoli would say to Mr. Hand, and so I'm going to vote the other way. But, I mean, there was a sense that changing your mind was a valuable thing right there. Right, AJ?
Right. Absolutely. And I love that. And in fact, my other favorite story about this is that James Madison, father of the Constitution, his last words on earth were that he had changed his mind. He was on his deathbed and his niece was there. This is according to lore, at least.
Yeah.
And he made some strange face and she said, "What's the matter, uncle?" He said, "Oh, nothing. I just changed my mind." So what did he change his mind about? Was it the bicameral legislature? Was it the wallpaper? We'll never know. But the fact was, that was his last act on planet Earth. So I love that. So I guess that would be one of the big meta takeaways. Let's be a little more open-minded and flexible and regain some of that initial fluidity that we had in early America. And, of course, the excitement for democracy that we had with the election cakes, now officially endorsed by the Colin McEnroe Show.
Right. So we're gonna have to stop there. Thank you, by the way, in terms of flexibility. One way you could have gone really Daniel Day-Lewis into this, like in terms of commitment, was to die of a currently treatable infection. So, and you know,
excellent,
I mean, if
point.
You were really serious about this, you probably would have done that. But thank you for being at least that not serious, because we want the next A.J. Jacobs book. They're all so great. This one's The Year of Living Constitutionally, One Man's Humble Quest to Follow the Constitution's Original Meaning. We're going to say goodbye, goodbye to you, A.J. Come back soon.
Thank you. I would love to. I am ready for number four.
Okay. And thanks to you for listening.
away. We dream of a brand new start.